can skeletal remains of dinosaurs still contain original flesh? Well, hello, my name is Ken Coulson with Creation Unfolding, and that is the question that I'm posing today, so please stay with us. Over the last 20 or so years, multiple examples of pliable, stretchy tissues have been found in dinosaur bones. And these include things like intricate blood vessels, many of which still have remnants of hemoglobin attached to vessel walls. There are examples of cells as well, including these bone-forming cells called osteocytes. Notice the long filopodia extensions that emanate away from the cell body, a feature that is indicative of exceptional preservation. Now here is an image of a delicate nerve fiber that was recently found within a Triceratops horn. And this is the first time nerve fibers have ever been found in dinosaur remains, and so this example bears testimony to the growing list of tissues that are being discovered every year. Now other cells have also been found, including these cartilage-forming chondrocytes from an 80 million year old duck-billed dinosaur. Look closely, and in this particular example, you'll see the dinosaur's chromosomes lined up in the middle of the cell as it prepares to divide. And if you think that is stunning, then what I'm about to show you is going to blow your socks off. As the scientists probed these chromosomes, they discovered the original organic remains of the duck-billed dinosaur's DNA. I mean, wow, this is amazing. Now, it's true the DNA was fragmented into tiny pieces, but some of those pieces were around 6 base pairs long, and perhaps even longer. Of course, this poses an interesting question. How can flesh preserve for 80 million years, and even 200 million years in some cases? And it's for this reason, of course, that these findings originally brought the scorn of the scientific community. Many scientists simply couldn't accept these results, and they accused the researchers of sort of sample contamination, where bacteria and bacterial biofilms are what was responsible for the soft tissues. Now, here's why these early investigators were accused of doing bad science. Most tissues are composed of proteins such as collagen, keratin, and elastin. Now, of these three, collagen is the most widespread in our tissues. So let's take a closer look at collagen to try and understand what all the fuss is about. Now, collagen is a 3-stranded protein with each strand composed of amino acids and each strand bound to the other strands by hydrogen bonds. Now, let's have a closer look at two of these joined amino acids. Each amino acid has a carboxyl group attached to one side and an amine group attached to the other. These two groups are joined by a peptide bond. And here's what's really interesting. These peptide bonds will break down with the addition of water. The water splits and gives one hydrogen and oxygen to the soon-to-be carboxyl group, thus providing stability in the form of a complete carboxyl group. The other hydrogen attaches to nitrogen, that nitrogen-hydrogen segment, and provides stability in the form of an amine group. Simplistically, water actually becomes a part of the chemistry. The splitting mechanism is called hydrolysis, and we say that the products of the reaction have been hydrated. Now, in case you are wondering, no, your body is not going to fall apart every time you drink a glass of water. That's because we have enzymes that ensure that these reactions only occur when they need to, when they're necessary, when your body needs to get rid of a cell or get rid of a protein. But after death, these enzymes are no longer at work, keeping those proteins together. And so although it still takes some time, proteins will eventually break down and disintegrate. So how long does it take for proteins to disintegrate? Well, I'm glad that you asked. After an organism dies, proteins will begin to denature and fall apart rapidly at high temperatures of around 60 degrees centigrade. But in solution, they'll begin to fall apart around 40 degrees centigrade for mammals and anywhere from sort of 5 to 30 degrees for fish. Now, since these temperatures are not easily attained in nature naturally, proteins could potentially last for hundreds or even thousands of years at lower temperatures where there's not a lot of water, of course. But, of course, we're still a long, long way away from 80 million years. And this is where the science really comes into play. A number of experiments have shown that collagen as well as DNA survive over longer periods given very low temperatures. Consider this paper published in 2011. Now, these researchers, they sped up the rate of collagen degradation in abundant water at high temperatures. And this, of course, meant that the collagen broke down very rapidly in just a few months. They then calibrated that rate to a surface temperature of around 10 degrees centigrade, which is apparently the proposed temperature of Britain over the past million years or so. Now, based on their modeling, they predicted that after 200,000 to perhaps as long as 700,000 years, only 1% of the total collagen mass would be left. And that's astounding. 700,000 years is a long time, but again, we're still far short of 80 million years, and certainly 200 million years. Now, what about DNA? Well, doing research on DNA, Thomas Lindell in 1993 determined that at low temperatures and with exceptional burial conditions, meaningful DNA sequences might be preserved for several tens of thousands of years. Again, doing research on degradation rates of DNA, Alan Toft et al. In 2012 calibrated the rate of DNA decay to fossils that ranged in age sort of from about 8,000 years ago till the present. Now, their research indicated that at a surface temperature of around 15 degrees centigrade, DNA would be broken down into single base pairs after about 130,000 years. Now, yes, we are talking about a DNA soup, but still, 130,000 years is fairly significant. So given these kinds of experiments, you can see why scientists were first extremely skeptical about soft tissues surviving in dinosaur remains. Now, essentially, the science says that organics can last anywhere from about 10,000 years to maybe as high as 700,000 years at low temperatures where there's a little bit of water. But what I'm about to say next is absolutely crucial. You see, all these studies were designed to answer questions about the preservation potential of soft tissues over archaeological time, not deep time. In other words, not multiple millions of years. And this is why the temperatures targeted in these papers are somewhat specific to paleo temperatures over the last 5 million years or so. Now, importantly, none of these studies, these earlier preservation studies, were trying to answer questions about the preservation potential of dinosaur soft tissues. And there's a big difference between the two. Archaeological remains are typically found at or near the surface, and conditions are usually dry with the absence of water, and temperatures are fairly low at around 15 degrees centigrade. Now, in contrast, dinosaurs lived in very hot Mesozoic climates that averaged between 33 and 38 degrees centigrade. But more importantly, dinosaur remains were eventually buried to depths of greater than 6,000 feet in North American basins, where the geothermal gradient increased temperatures to at least 100 degrees centigrade, perhaps higher. But not only that, water was abundant in the form of deep subterranean aquifers. Similar depths, temperatures, and watery conditions should be expected for other dinosaur fossil locations around the world. The application, therefore, of these preservation studies, the ones dealing with really archaeological soft tissues, to dinosaur soft tissues is a bit like comparing chalk with cheese. They're just not the same thing. Yet these studies are often referenced in scientific papers dealing with the preservation of dinosaur soft tissues over deep time. Consider this remark from such a paper. Multiple lines of evidence support the endogeneity of these recovered molecules in Cretaceous specimens, despite hypothesized temporal limits on molecular preservation of less than a million years for proteins and approximately 100,000 years for DNA. This is not an isolated case. Most scientific papers dealing with dinosaur soft tissue preservation use the same numbers from the same papers, give or take a few tens of thousands of years. Now, given the deep burial conditions of dinosaur remains where temperatures reached 100 degrees Celsius, but most likely higher, and given the presence of abundant water, what would these sort of numbers, these preservation numbers, drop down to? Well, I don't know, and that's because nobody to date has really crunched the numbers. Now, all of this is very important because, as we'll see in part two, Scientists involved in dinosaur tissue preservation continue to use the sort of 700,000 to a million year number as a baseline. In other words, if we can find another preserving mechanism that slows down the rate of protein degradation by, say, a factor of 100, then you just multiply the 1 million by 100, and hey presto, you end up with 100 million years. But as we've just seen, none of these original preservation statistics are useful for dinosaur soft tissue preservation. Finally, very few of these studies take into consideration a plethora of other criteria that are important to the breakdown of organics. Things like the work of microbes, pH, extremes of weather, such as freeze and thaw cycles, mud infiltration, worms, insects, plant roots, fungi, and even nuclear decay. Well, clearly the science says no, and really that should be the end of it. But in the last 5 years or so, a few papers have been published that claim that organic molecules actually can last multiple tens of millions of years. And this claim is based on chemical reactions that occur in organisms after they die. But that, of course, is a story for another time. So don't forget to look for part two of this video series, where I'm going to discuss things like ages, ales, and cross-linking. Don't forget also that I have a Facebook page, I have a blog, creationunfolding.com. There's the rest of the videos, and there'll be more coming, so please subscribe. And I have a book that deals with issues on mature creationism, so don't forget to look for that on Amazon. Okay, thank you very much. Goodbye.